All right, so we're going to be talking about a topic that I know very little, if next to nothing, about, and that is hemp, and specifically in the UK. So tell us about your role at Hempen.
Yeah, so the word hempen itself actually means of hemp, mm-hmm. which is, so it kind of describes everything. So my role at Hempen currently is as a production coordinator. But I, how I found it was about 18 months ago, and about, it's about June 2017. And a lot of information started coming about, coming out about CBD, cannabinoids. And it really, really interested me. Particularly the part in America, they were treating people with addiction. With cannabis in the states where it's legal, so CBD had sort of just started becoming available in head shops then over here, and as a vape liquid. So I actually started. That's what led me onto my journey with CBD, was looking into it as an alternative to smoking tobacco, mm-hmm. And to vape CBD, as I say, instead of smoking tobacco. And it led me down the path of research about it and looking into it. And I learned that hemp is cannabis, but it's a form of cannabis that is naturally low in THC. THC stands for tetrahydrocannabidiol. And it's the compound within the plant that's responsible for the psychoactive effects. So getting you high, as it were. So I'll say hemp is naturally low in this compound particularly, but is still abundant in all the other cannabinoids, which include CBD, which is cannabidiol. But there are actually over 100 cannabinoids. As you can tell, I'm quite passionate about it. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, so it's low in THC. It's actually legal to grow hemp in the UK. So there must be a hemp farm. So I just searched England hemp farm, and Hempen came up. And they were looking for volunteers, and I was like, wow, this is just, it's like it's meant to be. So I went along, and it was harvest time, and I volunteered during harvest, and I just had the best time. We were out in the fields in the sunshine picking the plant, and yeah, so that was my beginning of my journey with Hempen last year. And then I went back again this year at harvest, and I've become, as I say, more active in the production.
So has it always been legal in the UK? What's the history of the legal side of it?
Well, yeah, I mean, interestingly, going back to Henry VIII, he actually made it compulsory for all landowners to grow hemp because he used it for rope in his navy. It's actually an incredibly strong fibre, if not the strongest fibres that we know. So... It was, and it's also one of the oldest medicines that's been used widely here in this country, worldwide, up until about, well, really, when the Prohibition of Drugs Act came in, and it was classed, you know, alongside Class A drugs such as heroin, cocaine, and it became outlawed. It's become made an absolute enemy of us people. It's got such a stigma now. People sometimes, you know, walk past our hemp and stalls, and you can see them whispering each other, and you know, just even the notion of cannabis, and it's really, yeah, as I say, been given this terrible stigma, which is dangerous, because it's actually something that we all need in our diets.
Right, so it was outlawed and then like un-outlawed, was it? Have I understood that correctly?
Okay, so I mean, when cannabis became illegal, the whole plant sort of underwent this sort of stigma of being associated with bad things. To my knowledge, it's always been legal to grow hemp, but it's just been discouraged, made very difficult, not really made an attractive crop, you know, for farmers to grow. There's been no reason for them to grow it here. There's no sort of processing. So I think it's always been legal to grow hemp, but it just hasn't really caught on until recently. It's like a reawakening of our knowledge because hemp is not just useful for CBD, it's useful for a hell of a lot of other things as well.
Right. So give us some history of hemp. And so it's based in South Oxfordshire, is that right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's based in South Oxfordshire.
And how long has it been there? Who started it? How many people are involved with the project?
Yeah, it's so we've just had our third harvest this year, and it's been going for 4 years as a company, well, as a cooperative. It's quite a, although there are core members of the cooperative, there are also sort of quite a fluid movement of volunteers that pass in and out as well. It was founded by a guy called Joe McGann, and he had this idea that people could become self-sustaining, a community could be built around hemp, you know, that it can build houses, it's great for our health, it can create clothing, you know, it's got so many, it's got 25,000 or more end uses. So he had this notion, this great idea that he could build a community, a permaculture, and he found a farmer, a landowner who bought into his idea and very kindly sort of signed up, got the license to grow the hemp. And they started off in tents there, you know, throughout the year. In the winter, the founding members were just, yeah, in tents, watching the crop, growing it, starting the business, the cooperative. And now there's, you know, there's shipping containers, which is where we work. We've also got a static as an office now, which is great. It's it's a fantastic place to be. And I'd say people that are passionate about the plant, that have an interest in it, are invited, particularly at harvest time during September and October, to come and volunteer, sort of, you know, Monday to Friday for a couple of weeks, whatever you can give up, to get close to the plant to learn more about it.
I see. What volume, I mean, how much hemp do you produce in a season?
Yeah, I'm fairly certain that we have, I can't remember the exact numbers, but I do know that we've just harvested the most amount. We've just yielded, got the highest yield this year that we've ever had. Figures I'm not too on the primary production, I'm not too strong on, but we have three fields. It's a lot, we have a lot. I mean, there's been, I mean, 40 people on site at some days processing the hemp, and it's just non-stop, you know, from 9:30 in the morning we get up, we meet for morning circle, we check in with each other how we're doing, and then we get to the plant, we get to the hemp, and it's you know, cutting it down, making sure it's all looking good and checking it over. Yeah, there's a lot to do.
And so what happens to it? So you harvest it, and then where does it go to be turned into stuff?
Yeah, so we the seed is really, really nutritious, and it's got the perfect balance of omega oils, 3, 6, and 9, which is really important for us, particularly in vegan diets. I would suggest it for anyone, really, because it's better. It's even better for you than fish oils, and much better for the planet to leave the fish in the sea and take the oils that we need from the plants that we have on the land, and that are sustainable as well. So yeah, the omega oils, the seed is pressed for the oil, and the stalk we use as well for our tea, because there are still trace elements of the cannabinoids within the stalk, and it's got a really nice, sweet, subtle flavour as well. And then we process on site the remaining stuff.
Right. Oh, okay. So you actually process it on site. It doesn't just all go off to other places.
It's all on site. Yeah.
And does any of your production end up as building materials or like clothing stuff?
Currently, that's a sort of. The clothing part, there is no processing. This is a something that I'm quite passionate about at the moment. You know, getting to the bottom of, there's the British Hemp Association, of which the hemp trading company are members. They're the THCC. They make hemp clothing, and together with the BHA, they are lobbying to government to try and get the processing equipment, machinery needed, you know, we don't have any, well, we don't have much industry in the UK. We don't make a lot of things ourselves. And the problem is, at the moment, although it is good to make clothing out of hemp, it's great, it's being done in China. So if you're growing a sustainable crop in China and making the clothing there and then shipping it over here, the whole shipping it process really negates all the green, you know, work that's being done with making the clothing out of hemp, if you see what I mean. So it's, yeah, it's, we're on the cusp, possibly there's, you know, of it becoming something larger here. But our crop currently, we do work with hempcrete makers, I don't know what you make, what you call them, those people, not my area obviously, but builders, manufacturers of hempcrete, we are working with them, and it's definitely something that we would like to see more of in the future. Yeah.
So presumably that's some combination of concrete and hemp, is it? I don't know, instead of gravel or something? I'm just guessing.
I have read bits about it, but because it's not my, like, it's not the bit that really, really interests me, it doesn't really stick in my head very well. But I know that it's really insulating and really strong. You'd need to speak to a specialist exactly what it is about hempcrete that makes it special. But it's the fact that it's probably biodegradable as well.
I see. So talk me through, listen, I'm kind of embarrassed because I'm really thick on this topic.
There's no silly questions. That's why I always try and say to everyone, like, please just say it how it comes into your head, because that's the only way we're going to open up conversation about it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. That's cool. So I, for whatever reason, I never smoked weed when I was younger. I've never been into it. No particular reason. I just didn't get into it. And so because of that, I really know very little about it. So on the chemistry side of things, I know you already mentioned a few bits and bobs. I've heard you say cannabinoids, and I've heard you say THC, I've heard you say CBD. So I don't understand anything about that. So the stuff that you so the THC is the stuff that's psychoactive, right?
Yeah, let me strip it right back for you, to the beginning, and hopefully relate it on a level so you can understand, or everyone can understand. Every mammal on this planet has what is called an endocannabinoid system. So endo, that means within. And cannabinoid, that's what CBD is one of, and it's what THC is one of. What that actually means is our bodies are producing and have receptors for very similar chemicals in our bodies. It's the third largest body in our third largest system in our bodies.
Right.
And it controls things such as mood, appetite, digestion, pain, you know, all the receptors are, there's loads, I can't remember exactly how many.
What was it called again?
So the endocannabinoid system.
Right, so in other words, our body and our cells is equipped to receive these chemicals or whatever they are, molecules.
And scientifically, why that is because our bodies have evolved alongside this plant. As I've said, this plant has been part of humans and mammals. All mammals love it. Like, you know, you'll hear about people giving their dog CBD. My dog on the farm, when he just munches on it, he just munches on the hemp. We love hemp, and we recognize that it's nutritious for us and that we need it. It helps our bodies achieve homeostasis, balance, as I've mentioned, with temperature control and mood, appetite. It brings harmony. These chemicals bring harmony to all mammals' bodies. So when you ingest it or when you rub it on your skin, it works so well. And we have this endocannabinoid system because our bodies evolved with this plant, have for thousands of years have evolved alongside this plant.
So the THC and CBD are both cannabinoids, is that right?
That's correct. Right. Yes. Got You're it. Learning. This is good.
Got it. Yeah, that makes sense now. So the that's like the umbrella term, and then those two are both sort of sub things of that.
Yeah, yeah. The plant also contains flavonoids and terpenes as well, which
there's more.
So there's over 100 cannabinoids, but there are over 400 combined cannabinoids, flavonoids and terpenes.
Oh, right. Okay. I wasn't expecting that. I thought there was like two things to deal with. Okay. Yeah. Keep going.
Yeah, so for example, terpenes are really important for health. For example, like pine, a lot of cannabis plants or hemp plants will have pine or citrus terpenes, which again, that's a whole other kettle of fish. You can look into the benefits of terpenes. And flavonoids, again, citrus flavors. You'll hear, people talking about cannabis if it's lemon or tangerine. They're really, it's a very interesting plant and it's got a lot going on.
Right, so there's many different forms of this.
It's just so beneficial for us on so many levels. It kind of all of our senses. It's beautiful to look at because it's got sacred geometry within the leaves, and then the smells. It's kind of an all senses experience, this plant.
So have I understood it correctly that the CBD is in the hemp that you grow? Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, but it's quite low in THC.
That's right.
Okay, so.
UK law states that it must be under 0.2% THC, and they have strict list of seeds or that are approved under EU guidelines for hemp farmers.
I see. So hemp's not going to get you high, but then the benefit is the CBD is useful for health reasons. Is that right?
There's also CBA, CBG, CBN. These are other cannabinoids that also have been shown to have research. Research has shown to have benefits, health benefits.
Now, let's presume for a second that I'm a real skeptical dickhead who's completely skeptical about the health benefits of it, and I want to see sort of scientific proof of everything. I mean, I'm pretty open-minded, but what is the science behind all this in terms of the health benefits of CBD?
Well, I mean, the very fact that the UK is the world's largest producer of medicinal cannabis surely shows anyone that there's business in this, and it does work. I don't know if you're aware of that.
No, oh,
No,
no, no.
okay. So, There's British Sugar, and the company British Sugar own GW Pharmaceuticals. Now, interestingly enough, also our drugs minister, her husband is a major shareholder in British Sugar, as is Theresa May's husband. So they're major shareholders in British Sugar. British Sugar own GW Pharmaceuticals, who have the only license in the country to grow medicinal cannabis. So this is not hemp, this is with THC. They're growing in Norfolk. They've got a 45-acre grow. I think they've recently been featured on the BBC. For some reason, on their interviews, they always say that it's not THC cannabis that they're growing, but it is. And they make it into two forms of medicine. You've got Sativex for MS sufferers, and you've got Epidiolex for epilepsy sufferers. And they export it and sell it to countries around the world where it is, legal, and or you've got the money to do so. You can do it in this country as well. You can get prescriptions for those if you go privately. I think I spoke to a gentleman a couple of weeks ago. He said it costs four in his private prescription, it costs £450 a week for his MS Sativex prescription.
So the only company that's got the license to do that in the U UK, the Prime Minister's husband is involved with in one way or another.
Yes. And when I say that to people, like, if your face doesn't fall off at that statement, there's something wrong with you. It's,
I agree.
yeah.
I mean, it doesn't surprise me, unfortunately,
No, I know.
because
Yeah.
I accept that government's corrupt, but yeah, it's not right, you
Come
know.
on. But yeah, come like we know it's corrupt, but when you're faced with a fact like that, you're kind of like, oh my God, I've got to do something about this. This is wrong. Like, there are people in this country that are suffering that could benefit from this, and they're being held back for it because of the right people are just making the money from it, and it's so wrong. It really gets me. It really pisses
So,
me off.
in other words, if it wasn't restricted by licensing, you'd be able to begin growing it tomorrow, and then the supply would go up, the price would go down, and more people would be able to afford it for for their health
Well, I mean,
reasons.
different countries have got different models of how it works. I mean, different states in America have different models. Canada's got a different model. But what they have found is that it doesn't do any bad, you know, to legalize, to regulate. It definitely doesn't do any negative effects.
Yeah, you mean?
But I feel like in this country, it's so money orientated, our government right now, and that it won't, you know, that no one's doing anything about it. I don't know what we're supposed to do. We're not allowed to raise up. We're not allowed to protest. But, you know, you kind of shut down. But at the moment, that is the situation. No one else is allowed to grow it. No one else can even apply for a license to grow THC, as far as I'm aware.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and go on.
Yeah. It's, you know, it's almost questionable about, even though CBD is legal in this country, the legality of actually processing your hemp into CBD in this country for some reason is an absolute grey area. It's a minefield. Nobody knows, you know, what's right, what's wrong.
The stuff that company produces, the stuff that you said was like 450 quid for medical applications, does that get prescribed by hospitals and doctors in the regular sort of NHS system?
No. Well, there was this whole thing on the 1st of November that medical cannabis is now legal. You know, it can now be prescribed. But from what I've been reading, you know, and from experience of people that I know, it's not, you know, it isn't what you think. You can't just go to your doctor now and, you know, they haven't got a very extensive list of illnesses or diseases that are currently being treated with it, even though there is research to show that there is an extensive list of illnesses and diseases that can be treated with it. So I think currently there are only, I think it's MS, some forms of epilepsy. There was Carly Jane Benton, actually. She was in the news recently for getting a prescription for her pain. I think maybe she has, fibromyalgia. I'm sorry, Carly, if that's wrong, but maybe she has fibro, I think, and she's been prescribed flowers. So actually the buds of the plant, as opposed to an oil or a spray. So that it's all, even as, you know, myself, someone that reads a lot about it, it's constantly in my news feed. It can be confusing for me as to what is legal, what isn't legal, who is allowed it, where you can get it. Currently, it seems to be private prescriptions.
Right, I see. So it is a bit of a grey area. It's not. They've not made it clear or easy for people to understand what can and can't be done.
No.
That's annoying, isn't it? I mean, even if they're going to regulate it, and even if they're corrupt, it'd be nice if they would sort of just make it clear what you can do and what you can't, wouldn't it?
I guess they've got a lot going on at the moment.
Right.
They're probably, you know, Theresa May's profiting from the sales of GW Pharmaceuticals, you know, their medicines, and the fact that she's got a few people sort of going, hey, but we want to do that as well. There's other things going. There's bigger fish to fry at the moment, isn't there?
Mm.
I guess. I don't know. It's not clear, and there is confusion for people over it.
Who are the main advocates, or I mean, in the UK, who are the people that have got the biggest voices that are pro, that are campaigning in favour of hemp?
Hemp or cannabis, or one of the same?
Oh yeah, I'm not sure. I guess I was thinking more in terms of the CBD and medical application.
I mean, you've got a lot of groups. You've got the United Patients Alliance, you've got the UK CSC, UK Cannabis Social Clubs. They represent medical and recreational, because there is some debate within the community, you know, what is recreational, what is medicinal. Because of prohibition, everyone's kind of just been left to their own devices to smoke weed. And you know, I think a lot of us are, without perhaps knowing, sometimes subconsciously treating something within ourselves, you know, whether that be a depression or an anxiety, some form of mental health. A lot of people report, myself included, that it does help. Who else have we got? There's Callie Blackwell. I mean, she's been fantastic. She's the author of A Boy in the 7 Billion. Her son had two rare forms of cancer, and she defied the doctors and gave him cannabis oil. She's been on Loose Women during daytime TV, really getting, you know, out there talking about it. There's a lot of people.
I know we have to be careful in terms of you got to be careful with making claims about, you know, cannabis can do that, cannabis and health claims. You know, you can't you can't say that it cures things. You know, you've got to tread very carefully with the language. But just in terms of your own opinion, is there any other anecdotal stories you've heard of sort of miraculous cures?
Yeah, I mean, I get to do events up and down the country for hempen most weekends, and so I talk to people all day every day about this, and we've had many people come to the stand and just say, this is amazing, I love what you're doing, my dad took this or whatever, and not particularly about our stuff, but just, you know, they're coming and saying that they've had experiences with CBD, with hemp oil, arthritis, psoriasis, a lot of skin conditions, if it's used as a balm. There's a lot of success stories. There's a reason it's got so much attention, so much traction, and so much people are interested, people want to talk about it. It's because we feel a connection with this plant. As I said it before, it runs deep. People are really, really interested.
Is there any stuff actually on the shelves of supermarkets, or is this all stuff you have to buy at kind of, you know, sort of private markets and things?
Yeah, Holland and Barrett are probably the most famous high street retailer of CBD oil, although their product and methods of sale have been questionable. It was actually, I think, an employee of theirs got filmed by someone who went in posing as a customer, and they sort of were like, oh yeah, it can cure cancer, la 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 la, you know, they said things they shouldn't have done, basically making these medical claims, and that got viral, that video went viral, which was then, I think, when it really got brought into line, you know, you can't make any medicinal claims with this, because it doesn't work for everyone. It's not a one size fits all. If you take this is gonna cure you. You know, everyone has to try it for themselves, and but not really. I mean, there are in the cities, there are CBD cafes popping up, Brighton. I think particularly there are lots of places popping up around there, CBD cafes, CBD shops. In most vape shops now, you can get CBD vape liquid. So yeah, it's becoming more widely available.
And you said you do events every weekend. So what kind of things is that?
Yeah, I mean, we do London farmers markets every week. We're at Notting Hill, Marylebone, Queen's Park. Every Saturday and Sunday at the London farmers markets. And then we try to also do different events. So I personally have been doing a lot of vegan events. It's great. I mean, it's great nutrition for everyone, but it particularly appeals to vegans, the hemp seed oil for the omegas, and just generally because it is a vegan product. No, there is, our products particularly are vegan friendly. We have been going a little bit more mainstream recently, going to the foodies festivals. We went to Chester at Tatton Park, and then also we were at Edinburgh a couple of weeks ago. And the foodies festivals, they're not vegan festivals. They are pretty indulgent, sort of, you know, a lot of booze. There was a lot of gin retailers there, and a lot of different things. But we sat there and we stood proud and we were busy. And it was great to talk to. Yeah, it's great to talk to just anyone, the general public about cannabis, hemp.
And so how's it work? You'd go in a van and take product and stuff with you, and like, you take a whole stall and stuff?
Yeah. So the farmers markets, that's people we've got sort of stationed around London, but for me, yeah, I'm very fortunate. I've got my nice camper van, so I load that up with all the product and table and backdrop, tablecloth, and hit the road.
So if people want to get it, can they do mail order? Like, if people are listening to this and they want to, is there an online shop or something?
Yeah, Hempen does have an online shop. That is hempen.co.uk. And as I say, if you do live in the City of London, you'll find us around there. every weekend. We're on all social medias, Facebook, Instagram. And so, yeah, if you give us a follow on there, you'll be able to see where we'll be popping up. If you actually want to come and talk to us as well, talk to us about CBD.
And what's it in terms of the community and the lifestyle, like are people living on the farm? Like, do you live on the site?
Yeah, so we're required to work 21 hours a week, which can be difficult to stick to. Particularly, you know, I'm quite passionate about it, so I often end up working a little bit over 21 hours. But that is so that we can also enjoy life, you know, and have time for our own well-being, because there's no, you know, nothing good will happen if we're not looking after ourselves. So there is a lot of emphasis within the community, within the space, to really, you know, take your time, look after yourself. We can only do what we can do. We are volunteers at the end of the day. So there's about 12 of us on site at the moment. There's a cottage where some volunteers live in there, or some residents live in there. It's lovely. It's really, really nice. We all get together. Someone volunteers to do lunch and dinner every day, and we get together every meal time. We sit around the table. It's really cute. It's really cozy. There's a lot of love, and we're all there. You know, some people are there more for a sort of community basis. That's their passion. You know, that's their background, is forming communities. And then there are others of us who are sort of more hemp enthusiasts and have come to learn about communities and activism through, well, for me personally, this I'm probably talking about here, through being there.
Mm, I see. So if people are interested in getting involved and volunteering, do you need more help, or have you already got enough?
We always are on the lookout for particular people. I mean, we have it on the website. There is a volunteer form that people are more than welcome to go and fill in. Our volunteer coordinator, Sophia, will be on the receiving end of those. And during harvest, that's when we really do ask for a lot of people to come. And it's a great time of year. The weather is often really nice, and we have live music on every Wednesdays. We have fantastic live music. Not just that, but we also had, I don't know if you've heard of Potent Whisperer.
No.
He does spoken word, quite a lot of political, really inspirational spoken word. He came and performed for us this harvest. So, and also there's, as I say, yoga every morning. There's a lot of emphasis on it being a good time, as well as, you know, harvesting the hemp. It's, but all year round, I mean, if you've got a certain skill set that you think would lend itself to a farm, to hemp processing, then yeah, absolutely.
Right. Oh, okay. So people shouldn't be deterred from getting in contact. If they're curious, you know, they think they'd like to be involved, they should get in touch, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, we do ask really for a minimum of 2 weeks for people that would like to volunteer. Just so, I mean, because there is quite a lot to learn. Someone with a bit of an attention to detail, someone like myself, you know, if you've got a passion for the plant and it's not obviously within everyone's ability to volunteer. Everyone's got jobs and needs to earn a bit of dough. So, you know, if you want to sign 2 weeks of your holiday away to coming to the hemp farm because you are passionate about the plant, then absolutely, yeah.
Fantastic. Deborah, thanks ever so much for your time. That was really interesting. I definitely learned a few things, and I hope this interview will be of interest, and hopefully it'll help sort of spread the word a little bit.
Yeah, definitely. Me too. It's we call ourselves hemp evangelists. So that's what we do, spreading the good word of hemp.
Awesome. That's great. Thanks for your time. I'll put this online later and I'll send you a link so you can share it.
Fantastic. Thanks, Ben. It's great to talk to you.
Yeah, you too. All right. Bye for now.
Cheers. Bye.